I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, so that he would strengthen you from his glorious riches with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, so that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep Christ's love is, so that you may know that the love of Christ surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or imagine, according to his power that works within us. To him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forever. Amen. Volcanoes are so powerful and impressive, and their ash makes such beautiful, rich red soil. Around 5,000 years ago, up in North Queensland around Atherton and Innisfail, a series of volcanoes erupted, and that area today is some of the richest farmland in Australia. Come with us to explore something of God's fire amongst Indigenous people in North Queensland. Tim, that's your home country.
Yeah, the rainforest and the vegetation there is just so beautiful. It's just thick and it's like jungle, but there's certainly a real richness there in the soil where anything can grow.
That area of Pinnacle Pocket and around Innisfail also has a very rich spiritual heritage.
It was in these areas that that in the 1930s that the gospel came to these areas, and I'm blessed because it was my family that was involved, along with many other families, of course. You know, I just thank God that it went from generation to generation, and that we are fruit of that, and also bearing much more fruit for God's kingdom.
Well, that's what this film's all about. And I've got a list of over 80 Christian leaders who have come from that area in the last 60 years. Tim, God's revival fires up in North Queensland provided an awesome heritage for you.
But when I look back at our time in North Queensland, World of Worship was major events there. And it was just wonderful to see people coming together, and I think the key behind it all is to empower and to sow into our people is dreams and vision and the ability to be able to see that come to pass. You know, it was wonderful to be also a part of Praise Corroboree, which was held in the Great Hall in Canberra, in our National Parliament House. Looking back at it these years, it's leaders encouraging leaders and churches encouraging churches and people encouraging people.
With the help of a team of others, Tim and Di have pioneered the Emmanuel School in Cairns with around 300 students from 70 communities, and now another Christian school in Perth. In 2010, they held a conference on generational blessing, passing on the fire stick to future generations of apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, and evangelists. Another Aboriginal leader whose parents were in that North Queensland revival fire is Robin Green. She is one of Australia's best gospel singers and Christian teachers, and now lives near Kingaroy in Queensland with her husband.
More valleys, this is what it's about. It's about passing on our knowledge.
Yes.
Passing on the fire, the baton. You know, in a relay race, there's this baton that it's a four-man relay, you know, and it just keeps getting passed down. And the winning team is the fast, got the fastest time, right? You know? So we're passing on our knowledge, we're passing on what we have. And this is this documentary is great because the baby boomer generation that is to come is one day going to pick up this resource and learn about what happened 50, 60 years ago in a little place called Pinnacle Pocket. I can live in victory because of who you are, because you love me,
I will arise. Well, let's go visit Pinnacle Pocket. It's less than 2 hours' drive from Cairns in North Queensland, down the coast, and then up into the mountains to the Atherton Tablelands. Pinnacle Pocket is a farming area right between Yungaburra and Atherton, alongside the crater of an extinct volcano. The church there was established in the 1930s on a farm, and it became part of the Assembly of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. My story, this is my song. The only time that we started on Pinnacle Pocket was really a bad place. It was really under the son of Satan. There was prejudice really bad there, you know, that before they came, black people couldn't mix with white people. They had, young people would fight and all that sort of thing.
Gambling and alcohol were major problems. They used to send up a skyrocket to call people to a Chinaman's place to gamble. When he was 8 or 10 years old, Charlie watched his uncles and aunts drunk and fighting constantly in the kitchen and out in the paddock. There was never enough money to buy food, and the children were starving.
There's an old man called Old Grandad Coldus, and he come from down Melbourne somewhere with Pastor Andy Knab and those lot, and he came and bought that farm in Pinnacle Pocket. So he wanted some of our uncles to go over there and to work, do a bit of fencing in that farm. And you know, the plant was so much prejudiced that they, when they went over there to do fencing, he brought him inside and they sit around the table and, you know, they all have meal, and then he called him brother, and that, and they were surprised. And they come over and they tell all the others, they said, you know, you want to come over see this old white man? He called us brothers. Mm. You know, it was something strange for them to call white men calling them brothers.
Our history here came straight out direct from the Welsh Revival, which happened over there in 1904. The farmer that came out here and from the Revival in Welsh came out and bought a farm and started farming here. And some of the workers were South Sea Islanders, and they're my ancestors, Aboriginal people, Chinese and people like that. So he started his farm, and naturally he's a Christian, wanted to share the gospel, so he shared it with his workers who were our ancestors, and they got saved.
In the 1930s, a small weatherboard church was built on the Coulter's farm, which became packed as the word of God spread amongst the people.
So you've got to remember, these people were illiterate, didn't know how to read and write, and that. But some of the great ministries came from that era, which was my ancestors. One was named Willie Giblet. So he was on the scale or level of R.A. Torrey and D.L. Moody and people like that, because he had this anointing on him. He used to come out to our little church here, illiterate, and yet when they put the Bible in front of him, he could preach and read every word. And there's one particular time the Lord used to speak directly to wake him up and go to a place and share the gospel. So this one night he said to Brother Willie, I want you to go to Herberton. But this particular day he caught the train up And as you're sitting on the train, never said a word, people started falling down in repentance, the Holy Spirit's power, and the whole train, that carriage anyway, gave their hearts to the Lord. And it was the same man that went up the road here a little bit, old Granny Roses, 103 years old, sitting in the wheelchair, and the Lord told him to go up and pray for her. And everybody was picking beans over here at the time. Heard this jumping around and somebody screaming and yelling out. When they looked up there, he was this old lady, 103 years old, out of the wheelchair, and then along came Pastor Spore.
Con Spore became the pastor of Pinnacle Pocket Church in 1946. He was a very practical man, as well as a leader filled with the Spirit of God. 2 years later, he purchased the Coulter's farm and then gave the church to the Assembly of God, as well as land for housing for the Aboriginal people. Pastor Spore also bought an ex-army blitz truck to transport the people and goods, including the daily school run for the children and food from Atherton. It was used so much that the engine was replaced every year and a second blitz was bought. On two occasions, a group travelled 2,500 kilometres to Sydney for a conference. It was 40 miles an hour top speed in the Blitz on rough dirt tracks with no bridges for the many creek crossings. The Blitz was eventually replaced with a Chevy bus.
Well, Baratan had a passion for those people. He just didn't preach. Yeah. He preached with a passion. Yeah. And it was nothing to see a dozen people out in front on a Sunday morning bawling their eyes out.
Oh, they'd get to one another and ask for forgiveness often.
Yeah.
Before they had communion.
And he said, there's someone here with a heart problem. I knew it was me. I knew the Lord was told I wasn't saved at that time. So I nearly died a few months before that, having my last child. But after that prayer, I was healed. I knew I was healed. And I went to my doctor and I said to him, I'm healed. I don't want any more tablets. He said, oh, what doctor did you go to? I said, no, Dr. Jesus. I said, do you know about how many healings that happened in Pinnacle Pocket? And he said, yeah, I know all about it.
My dad is Larry Geeser from Murray Island. My dad was brought out as a young man from Murray Island to look for work here when the war, Second World War finished. They'd come across, and they came across to Innisfail, and one of the boys got saved and was talking about how God had changed his life. And so the boys from up the islands, they started to get curious and they heard about Pinnacle Pocket, where the Spirit of God was moving and the fire fell in this place, the fire of God. And these men, they came out of curiosity. My dad came from the islands. He was the next in line to be the chief or the medicine man. It ran, it came down that bloodline. And when Dad came here, they sensed the powerful move of God in this place. And it was at that time that he gave his heart to the Lord for one whole week or more. He couldn't talk. He couldn't talk English. He couldn't talk in his own tongue. And that's how he came to meet my mother. My mother was here in the village here at Pinnacle Pocket.
There were many baptisms in the church and strong Aboriginal leadership developed. Finally, in 1959, it was thought that it was time for a change in leadership and an Aboriginal pastor, Stirling Minicon, was appointed. At that time, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders were still under the control and the discrimination of the Aboriginal Protection Act.
My father was the first Aboriginal pastor to pastor that church, and I take my hat off to Pastor Con Spore, who actually had the gumption, the courage, who took the risk, particularly in that era when we were still under the Act, to give the leadership over to Aboriginal people in church ministry. Because back in those days there, church was the only other thing that we had on our communities. That was the only place where we could gather, where we could meet with each other, we could talk about a whole range of things, we could pray together, we could sing together. That's where we as a community met. Pinnacle Pocket to me was like heaven. I mean, it's I grew up there, where amongst all the community there, and it has a huge, big, lasting effect upon my life, my ministry, the way the things that I do, the very core of who I am, comes from a lot of the learnings and the teachings of living in that community there with all of our people up there in that area. I learned to worship God, learned to love God, learned to enjoy the fruits of who I am.
My little eldest daughter, she got a sickness, and that's when I hated God. And I said, I hate the Christian, I hate God. All those years I suffered, but I forgot how the women prayed, you know? They prayed every hour of the day and night. They was praying for me, I tell you that. And then one day, Sally Turpin, she said, Jesus can heal you of a broken heart. I said, yeah, well, I want to see him do it. I was really begging him. I said, I want him to do it. And I said, but he's got to come to me. I said, I'll meet you there, and you better be there if you're real. Because I was desperate, and so... Anyway, I waited, I got the kids up, got them dressed, and I said, now see where you are now, Jesus, if you're real, send me a ride.
God provided their ride to church in a remarkable way, and during the meeting, Eddie's young brother got up to speak.
He quoted Luke 4:18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And then it goes on to say, to heal the brokenhearted. And I said, that's it. And I just looked, and I saw this. I saw the sword coming at me. You wouldn't believe this. The sword flaming. And it hit me right in, the Word of God.
I came on the scene here around about 1960. And this is where I was saved under the ministry of Sterling Minicon. And right at the very start, these men... got around me, men like Peter Morgan. They were very instrumental in my early days of my Christian walk.
After 6 years, Eddie and Rita went to Shepparton in Victoria for a holiday. They ended up staying for almost 8 years. He became the pastor of a small church with only 11 people, but it developed into a large, vibrant church. And then God challenged him solidly.
These are the very words he said. I want you to come home and open the door. And I didn't want to leave there, down there, because everything was going good.
Yes.
Right at the end of that 7 years, there was a revival, big revival.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a beautiful job. Well, my heart dropped. I could have been a millionaire today.
Yes.
And this happens. But anyway.
You were obedient.
Sulked all day and...
You sulked all day.
Yeah, that's a job there. And when I came home in the afternoon, I didn't know how to tell Rita.
Yeah.
And what the Lord had said to me. Anyway, I put on a bright face and walked in, and I said to her, I said, you know what, sweet? She said, yeah, the Lord wants us to go home.
Pinnacle Pocket leadership changed a lot after Pastor Spohr left. Many that he had trained moved into ministry in other places, and a lot of the community supports fell away. The village water supply, electricity, employment, the bus for the school children, the village and the church. Families moved away to find employment, and the village was finally closed.
When I came home, I came straight out here and had a look around here. The place was overgrown, grass, all the houses that was here all burnt down, and nothing, and the doors closed. And yeah, so we had the first meeting. It's only just my wife and the children and this one lady.
Oh.
The second meeting was, there was 9 altogether then.
Yes.
And one of them was Sterling Minicon. He came from over Dajara.
The houses in the village had been burnt, but the Pinnacle Pocket spiritual fire spread to many places during the 1960s. Families moved to other parts of Queensland, to the Northern Territory, Western Australia, and all over Australia, taking their fire sticks with them to light new fires. People from all around began to travel back to Pinnacle Pocket for prayer meetings, conventions and church services.
The church began to grow. And they were coming from everywhere. And the Anglican and the Baptist Church and the Presbyterians, they were all coming here.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Was that because of the move of the Holy Spirit?
It started off, that was the move, off like that. We ended up with the largest Sunday school, I think possibly in Queensland, the largest youth group and the most talented group in Queensland. They were a top team.
Yes.
Yeah, and the biggest women's ministry.
Praise God.
The prayer meeting, well, it was mixed.
Yes.
The Anglicans and the Baptist, mainline churches used to come out here. And we all used to bunch up in that old church.
The old church was far too small, and one day Pastor Eddie felt God spoke to him and gave him a vision of a new church building. God provided the finance, the materials, the labour, miraculously. The church premises were set up for camping, for conventions at Pinnacle Pocket, which were held for over 20 years at Christmas and Easter, as well as many long weekends. The conventions were a major part of stirring up the fire in people's lives, and there were many miracles and healings, eyesight restored, people able to walk again. Pastor Eddie also trained up new leaders, sending some off to Bible colleges and schools of evangelism, and then supporting them to start new churches in Herberton, Cairns, and many other places. As well as being involved in evangelism and discipleship, these new leaders are now involved in community issues, including domestic violence and real employment opportunities for Indigenous people. Well, let's head down the mountain from Pinnacle Pocket to Innisfail, a town at the mouth of the Johnstone River. Innisfail is the centre of a large sugar industry, and in the 1860s, many Pacific Islanders were brought to Queensland to cut cane and work in the mills. Pastor Tim Edwards' grandparents, Jack and Annie, lived in Innisfail. In the 1930s, Annie was introduced to an Irish sailor-turned-preacher who arrived in Innisfail. David Bell's wife, Wynn, was the sister of Pinnacle Pocket pastor Con Spore. Pastor David introduced Annie to Jesus Christ. Annie's son-in-law, Laurie Ramsey, takes up the story.
She found the Lord and she became a real fire stick for the Lord, or a leader. The meetings I used to have was in old Granny Edwards and her husband Jack's house, and it was behind, right in the centre of town, but it was behind what is called the Shy Hall, and that's the biggest building in Innisfail. But there was a little house there, and that's where they had the prayer meetings. One night they were praying and the Holy Ghost fell down, and they began to speak in strange tongues, funny tongues. So the people, and anyhow, there was the glory of the Lord came down so powerful that they could hear him in the main streets and everywhere there. And the people wondered, and so they got the police to come down to see if they could stop the fire.
Police wanted to know what all the noise about.
Yeah.
And so Uncle Joe was telling them that that was in the Bible. He was telling in Acts 2:4. And the policeman said, you better shut up. If you don't shut up, then I'll throw you in the water.
Yeah.
And he stopped there.
Many people made commitments to Jesus Christ, and they experienced many miracles of healings and deliverance. They started to have prayer meetings and services at the Mows property at Nins Creek, where there were no close neighbours to be disturbed by their noise. They had to row a boat or walk there through the mangroves and crocodile-infested waters of the Johnstone River, and the church bought a boat to ferry the people there. In 1938, a church was built in Marulion, about 10 kilometres south of Innisfail. It was made from bush timber and had a dirt floor and grass roof, and was used every day of the week for meetings. Some of the people even moved out to Marulion, and they held outreach meetings opposite the Marulion pub using carbide lights. During the Second World War, many of the people, including Nana Edwards, moved up to the tablelands around Pinnacle Pocket for security reasons. They attended Pinnacle Pocket Church, and it had a big influence on many of them. We will see more of the Edwards family and their influence later. After the war, they moved back to Innisfail, and the Innisfail Church rented and then later purchased a shop and house in Gladys Street for their meetings. In 1960, a concrete block church was built using the same single block mould used in Pinnacle Pocket. Within 20 years, this was too small, and 10 acres of land was donated to the church in South Innisfail. The ministry of this church and its facilities today are a real credit to the people and the church, which is now known as the Tabernacle of Yeshua. Anthony Edwards, the grandson of Jack and Annie Edwards, is its senior pastor.
They used to walk for hours to meetings, after prayer meetings.
Yeah.
They'd walk from Moanda to a prayer meeting.
In the early days.
That's right, they used to have, carrying a hurricane.
Prayer was a constant passion of the people. Rod Minicorn spoke of this passion in his father, Sterling Minicorn.
He found the key to touching God was prayer. And they have these, what they call tarry meetings. When they start these tarry meetings, that means that they lay everything aside and they'll go to that church, and they would not come out of that church until God did something. And that was day and night. And I could hear them praying in this church day and night, day and night. I don't know, you know, if they ever went out to the toilet or what, but I know they were in there praying, these old ladies. And most of them, the men would come home from work and they'd join them. And it was a tarry meeting, waiting on God. There was a fast and there was prayer. And that's when this power drew me in. Because I walked past the church, you know, and it kind of something, I don't know, like it's a hard thing to explain, but I was drawn into this too, yep. See. And I remember kneeling down at this, on the floor there, on this, they had only had little wooden seats. And no back on them, you had to sit pretty straight up and down, you know. And I can remember this power hit me the first night I went in. Mate, I don't know what happened to me. I made a lot of noise, you know, and I was really worshipping and praising God. I just couldn't stop it. And then on the third night, wow, all heaven broke loose on my life. And at the time, I could not read. I could not write or do anything like that. But that third night, this Holy Spirit hit me, took over my tongue. And then I remember about 3 o'clock in the morning going home from the church, and these old ladies still in there, not worried about me, but they just wanted God. I went home and I picked my mother's Bible for the first time I read in my life, the Bible. From that day till this day, I just can read the Bible.
That's amazing, isn't it?
Oh yeah, it was a miracle. I was there from 15, 16, 17, and it used to be powerful, and God's power used to fall, fire used to fall from heaven.
You mean people literally saw fire?
Oh, yes, yes, yeah. Oh, yeah. And way back there, this intercessory prayer, it wasn't like intercessory prayer today. Intercessory prayer was they just wouldn't do nothing until God came along. You know, but they didn't pray and give messages. You know, intercessory prayer today has kind of got a different term, more prophetic. They believe that they pray, they get a message. And sometimes I think that maybe there's a little bit of controversy, because prayer, when these old ladies and people used to pray, they didn't give messages.
So there was nothing of self and ego?
No,
and
nothing sort of self-ego. And when they got in that prayer tent, They meant business with God. You could hear them. You could hear them wailing. They was the wail.
So they wailed. Yep. They praised God.
Yep.
And that was the sort of.
They were on their hands and knees, you know,
and calling out to God over situations and people.
Yep. And God used to answer. God, well, He had to.
Once a week they go to Atherton and have an open air in the middle of the street.
We used to have a practice on a Sunday afternoon for the open air, you know, to get choruses and everything sorted out. I think mainly for my benefit, so I could know which ones they were going to sing. And
so she'd be out there with the pump organ, the street.
They had a little folding organ
to
take to church and take to the town.
That's
well, we used to take a blitz load full of people with us.
Yes, a blitz again.
So we had all the people with us who wanted to go. Because not too many people had their own cars.
Yeah.
To take the young people everywhere and have that meeting in the church first. Then we go Mount Garner. We used to go up there, and Air and Brisbane and all those places.
Hallelujah.
Take them young people. I didn't go to Brisbane,
but
used to take the young people and some of the older ones too.
Yes.
Used to go to see a different minister coming to Brisbane. Yeah, hear them and they come on with all. They're so happy.
Yeah.
Arnold Congu was born in Atherton in 1931. He grew up in Herberton and Yungaburra. He attended Pinnacle Pocket Church with his family, where he committed his life to Jesus Christ and was trained as a missionary by Pastor Con Spohr. He married Margaret Roses, his childhood sweetheart, when he turned 18. And started missionary work in towns around the area.
He headed west to Mount Garnet and established a church there, and after 9 years handed it over to new leaders from Pinnacle Pocket and Innisfail. Then he went further west to Georgetown, ministering in the area for about 6 years.
One night I was in Georgetown, where we were there ministering the word to the people there. The Lord spoke to me at night and three times to me, he said, go to the Ord River. The dream that I had where there was a group of people were sitting under the Moab tree. And then the Lord spoke and he said, go to the Ord River.
Arnold went in and woke his daughters and asked, you girls know where the Ord River is? They pulled out their atlas and found it. That's in Western Australia. We'll have to cross two borders. Well, you kids, that's where we're going. And packing up the three cars with 9 children in tow, off he went.
The Lord provided us with food, like wild turkeys. Yeah. We shot wild turkeys and kangaroos and tyres for the cars. Yep. And as we was going along, I saw the Lord appear to me when I was
He came. How old were you?
I was 6 years old.
Yes.
Travelling in the car, and I happened to look up at in the sky, and the Lord came to me.
Yeah.
And I knew the Lord was with us as we were travelling.
After 18 months in Darwin, Arnold felt that the Lord said it was time to move on. They lived in Kununurra for about 7 years and reached out into surrounding areas, and at one point made a trip to Timber Creek.
The Lord
Lord just spoke to me and said, that's the man you've got to see. And when we turned around and when he came up, and I asked him about us having some meetings. So he said, yeah. So we went down, we had meetings there, and we had a tremendous roll-up. And the whole family got saved. And they told us about Buller. We were going up through the camp there, and here I saw these group of people there, half a dozen of them. It was in the same, with a dream I had. It was these six people.
And they were sitting under a bottle tree?
Yeah, bottle tree, yeah.
Well, I first came to know the Lord in a real way. You know, we thank God for our pastor, Congo. He came all the way from Queensland and brought the good news, brother, and telling us the truth, how to live a life for the Lord. Praise God.
What kind of a life did you live before you came to Christ?
Oh, praise the Lord. I was in the wreck. I've been real down in the dump before I came to know the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal saviour.
Well, they used to worship the Hadle, worship. And me and brother Jack Little used to, the carry with the whole people used to make us carry all the way from the Waterloo to here. And, you know.
So how did you carry? You walk?
Walk. Yeah.
You walk. How many miles?
All walk from, say, walk for 2 weeks. One of the people kind of worship, well, they kill him, young people and the young girl, they kill him. That's what they used to do.
They kill young girls?
Yeah, and young boys.
For the next 30 years, Pastor Arnold and his family gave themselves tirelessly to reach people with the gospel in the northwest and the centre of Australia. Thousands of lives were radically changed from hopelessness through the power of Jesus Christ and Holy Spirit. There were healings from brain tumours, the blind could see, the dumb could speak, cripples could walk, and even the dead were raised to life.
Teams went right down as far as Alice Springs and into the Central Australia and the Anangalpitanjara lands. And many people came to a total new experience of life in all its fullness through the power of Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit.
Pastor Arnold Congu went to his eternal reward just 5 days after our film crew interviewed him.
Just want to wave goodbye now, Pastor Arnold.
Wave goodbye.
Wave into the camera.
Wave to the camera.
And say goodbye.
Say God bless.
God
bless you.
God bless you.
Peter Morgan was a Yidinagi man from the Mullumbulla clan. He was taken from his mother at 2 years old by the government and raised in an Anglican boys' home on Palm Island in Queensland.
His dad was a cane cutter, and he always tells his story that he was told that you could find girls at church. So he came here when he was about 21 years of age and came to this church.
Yeah.
And of course he met my mother. So he gave his life to the Lord. Well, Dad said when he got born again in Pinnacle Pocket, he said he had 2 weeks he couldn't speak a word of English. He was so full of the Holy Ghost that they had to write notes to take to the grocers because they couldn't speak any word in English.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and he was felt like he was floating on air. Mum was a Christian before Dad because she was already here at Pinnacle Pocket.
Yes, yes.
And she was very gifted in music. She loved teaching children. My parents loved young people, so there was always, the house was full of young people.
Yes.
That's what I'm told.
Yes.
They looked after 17 boys at one stage.
Praise
here
God.
In Pinnacle Pocket.
Praise the Lord.
And Mum was a great, great cook.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
So. But they had a passion for God, you know, that I never saw waver over the years. And right till the end of their life, they had this passion for God.
At the end of 1966, Peter planned to go fruit picking down south. But as they were driving through Townsville, he felt the Holy Spirit told him to turn right and head for Charters Towers. He replied, "No, I'm going south to go fruit picking." But he obeyed and went to Darwin.
Yeah, he pioneered the work for the Assemblies of God, and he felt led of the Lord to go around Arnhem Land. So he travelled around a fair bit throughout the territory.
And the family too?
All of us. We had a band called Jezariah Gospel Band. We travelled about 3.5 times around Australia. Felt led of the Lord that God told him he had to set foot on the four points of Australia. And
amen.
He had that vision and passion to just travel, you know, and stir up with evangelism. Yeah. Tim Spohr, whose father built this the old church here. Yeah. Tim travelled with us for about 3 years as well. Yeah. They were really great times, you know.
Yeah.
My sister and I, we used to sing as the Morgan sisters.
Yeah.
Auntie Evelyn Lower was living in Panawanika when the band arrived there.
You came to Panawanika, town, Cliffs Robe River Iron Ore mining town in the northwest of Western Australia. There was no power of the spirit there, and your dad and mum and that band brought in the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. There was great strong iron ore men that come from the mine with their helmets and their dusty red dust, and they just, your dad preached to them, fiery preaching, and they just were slaying in the spirit, and some of them were just bawling their eyes out.
I lost my sight when I was 11 years of age. I had a kidney infection. They don't really know what caused it, but I lost my sight and the use of my leg, so probably all up I was blind for about 5 days. But my parents, the doctor said there was really nothing that they could do. I had to go to Adelaide to have some sort of operation. And my dad said, "Look, I believe in the power of prayer, and I believe that God can heal my daughter." And prayed for me. I had an awesome encounter with the Lord. I remember lying in my bed one night, just sort of little 11-year-old girl bargaining with God, you know, like I was really desperate to see again. And so I just sort of said, "Oh Lord, you know, if you heal me, I'll sing for you." And I think it was that night, I thought the nursing sister had come into my room, and I put my hand out, but this person just took it and held it. And the moment he took my hand, I knew it was Jesus. And just a sensation that went through my body was like, just, I turned my head and I said, "Jesus," you know?
Yeah.
But he was gone.
Yeah.
Because it only takes less than a second for the Holy, you know, God to touch you and heal you. So I knew that my visitor was Jesus. And 3 days later, I regained my sight.
Hallelujah.
2 weeks later, the use of my legs. In 1986, I launched my solo career and released my first album called Here's the Answer.
Yes. Congratulations.
That's still my biggest selling album. My husband said, "Oh, look, I've got $5,000. He said, "Well, let's put it towards you doing an album."
Yeah.
Before I knew it, I was recording.
Yeah.
So that kind of launched my career.
Years later, Robin took her father to America.
There was a lot of people there that had cancer. Dad and I prayed for these people, and a lot of them got healed. When we were growing up, he sort of taught us a lot of things about the Word and how to minister. From the early days, right from when we used to go to Bulla River with Uncle Arnold Congu and travelled around, he sort of taught us how to minister, you know, in God, pray for the sick, how to preach. So it was pretty awesome, you know. I just grew up under he mentored us. He would say things like, "Robin, you're going to preach better than me, but I need to make sure that I carry the pastor's baton on, and that you preach better than me, you sing better than me," you know. He said, "I want that for my children." And he had a grade 3 education. But the Holy Spirit, you know, came upon him, and then he knew how to read. He could read the Bible. But one thing I always remember, my dad was to say, "There's going to be a heaven-sent Holy Ghost revival."
Hallelujah.
I didn't mean to preach that every time he'd preach.
Yes.
You know. So it's happening. I believe it's happening. I believe this is going to be this massive explosion, the fire of God, and a fire can't actually be quenched, you know. Especially we're talking about the fire of God, the one that's in your belly, that's in your bones. So you can't contain it, you know. This it's generational, and I believe God is just gonna breathe on it again.
That fire of God has also been passed on to Robin's sisters and to the next generation, including Robin's son Nathaniel. The Assembly of God Church asked Sterling Minicon to take over as pastor of the Pinnacle Pocket Church in 1959.
His conversion was a very strange conversion. He was out driving cattle in the outback or somewhere near Gained or somewhere, or around that area, because he was a drover. And one night when he left settled the cattle down, and he went to have a rest, sleep, and all of a sudden this stranger thing happened to him. That something he didn't understand was the Holy Spirit fell on him, and he started to speak in an unknown language, way out there in the bush by himself. So what happened was he took the cattle to where they went, and he came back a preacher out from that experience.
Pastor Sterling's fervent prayer brought revival to many places in North Queensland, including Pinnacle Pocket, and it also laid a foundation for the ministry of his sons, Rodney and Raymond. Rod has been a world leader in areas of warfare prayer that has brought release from Satan's powers for many people in many places.
I guess the strength of who I am and what I do here in Redfern, and as well as in this country, as well as in other parts of the world, comes from my deep-rootedness in my history, my heritage back there in Pinnacle Pocket and back in Queensland. Since Pinnacle Pocket, actually, when we did come down into Cairns and lived there, and then I saw, you know, the reality of racism in the church and the ways in which they treated not only my father but every Aboriginal leader in far north Queensland there, I did say to myself and to my father, I said, "Dad, if this is Christianity and if this is church, you can have it, because I don't want to be a part of that kind of racism. If they can't recognise you and give you the respect that you or a lot of those other wonderful leaders, then where's the future in it for me or for any of the young people that they've been discipling and teaching?" And so I left the church. And it's only by God's Spirit that He called us back into the church. And once I came back into faith with God, in relationship with God again, after many years of being out there in the outer, it was those old teachings from those days that sort of encapsulated your spirit. I had gone through the Assemblies of God Bible College up here in Katoomba back in the 1970s. And once we graduated, I started my ministry out here at La Perouse. And that was a very great and privileged opportunity for me to be the pastor at La Perouse there, or the youth leader at least, youth pastor, simply because that's the beginning points of Christianity here in this country.
Ray and his family moved to Western Australia, where he was pastor of One in Christ Church in Katanning, before studying at the Baptist College and Murdoch University, graduating with a double major in theology and education. Then World Vision appointed him to head up its Australian Indigenous program based in Sydney.
I felt in my spirit that God had called us back here with one particular purpose in mind, and that was to knock on the doors of the church here and say, "Listen, you've been in my country for 200 years now. Where is the Aboriginal church in this country? Where is my church? You can send all these missionaries overseas with all these dollars and stuff after 200 years. Where is the Aboriginal church? Where is our leaders? Where is our pastors? Where is our bishops? Where's all of these wonderful things you're boasting about overseas in your own backyard?" So here in this city here, I've knocked on a lot of doors here, got lots of rejects. Very disheartening, very disillusioning, and it's very easy to give up. But like I say, once again, you've got to draw upon your heritage, your rich spiritual heritage, especially when you realise that those men of God, like I mentioned before, my father and Sterling Minicon and the Hollingsworth brothers, you know, they went through worse situations than we did, worse racisms than we did, They were excluded from so much stuff, and you can see the pain and the struggles that they went through. Their Aboriginal people are the highest adherents to Christianity. We're 74% of our people would identify with the Christian religion, and yet the reality of having those churches to represent those communities is almost zero. It's not there, it's not supported. There's a lot of independent works and all of that, but in terms of the denominational challenges, it's not there. What was happening there at Pinnacle Pocket was a very miniature opportunity for Aboriginal people to take control of their own destiny under God. And once Aboriginal people did take that opportunity of being under God, you know, the Holy Spirit could do his work, and that work is still happening throughout the lives of those who've been touched by God's Spirit there at Pinnacle Pocket and those other places. Right throughout that whole area there, the ministry that ensured out of Far North Queensland there was, in my opinion, one of the strongest spiritual movements that had a movement here in this country here. Unknown by the outside world as well as the outside church, but for us who were involved in it and who were immersed in the workings of God's Spirit at that time, we remember it very vividly and very clearly, with great memories of what God can do amongst us.
In the 1930s, many of the Innisfail Indigenous people moved out to Marulion when the church was built there, including Granny Edwards, her husband Jack, and their 10 children.
Although he never became a Christian at that time, but he made sure his children went to church. He would help the church in the building progress and in every other kind of way. He did bring up his children very, very strictly. And that's where the children went to school, as well as having church out there. And there was a beautiful move of the Lord, even out at Marulion.
The old Mum Edward, she was a great lady. And I think if it wasn't for her, I would just say that. That she made us to be stable in God. Mm. She sort of been the backbone of the church. And she used to teach us the ways of God.
After their time on the tablelands around Pinnacle Pocket during the war, the Edwards clan moved to the mouth of the Johnson River, opposite Nins Creek.
I remember as a boy many times going fishing with my parents, or whether it was uncles or aunties in the boat. There was they'd always talk about church, and they'd always talk about those early years of God moving in Nins Creek, but also in the township there of Innisfail. Pastor Laurie and Auntie Mary at that time were our first Sunday school teachers, and our grandmother had a house there, and all around that house, you know, like the next door neighbours. It was like all of our families lived in the next door, and they all owned their own blocks of land at that time, and there was the community there, and our grandmother's little shed at the back. It was just a tin shed with a dirt floor, but that was our Sunday school. And so that little shed in the backyard was packed every, when I say every week, it was almost every day. I just think about the blessing of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, you know, in ministry. When I think about Pinnacle Pocket, when I think about my hometown of Innisfail and all the ministries that have come out of our grandmother, you know, not just myself, I have a cousin who is Pastor Anthony Edwards, who is the pastor now of the Innisfail Church. along with his wife Selena, other cousins who, the Ramsey family, who are in ministry today, doing things. They've pioneered work along with their parents.
As a teenager, Tim went off with the crowd into drugs and other illegal activities. The church had got to a rather low point with only two or three families. Tim's parents would come home and talk about the prayer meetings that they'd started. They would drive around in their car and pray in the town and the district, and God showed up and answered their prayers. And suddenly, many people were filled with the Spirit, not just the Indigenous people, but business people, dentists, electricians, real estate, the mayor even. Then Tim's mother died suddenly when he was just 19 in 1978.
It devastated me, because she was, you know, a mother's prayer. How I got out of car crashes, how some people had shot at us, and many other incidents. Not long after that, I woke up on a tennis court after a wild night out, and I heard like a voice inside of me saying, "Come on, Tim, you've seen everything you wanted to see. You did everything you wanted to do. Give Jesus a go. Give Jesus a chance in your life."
Tim said yes to Jesus, and God started to move in his life. He also started to see many of the Innisfail people moving out in ministry to other parts of Queensland and across the Top End. Tim decided to go fruit picking for a season with his brothers in Victoria.
That's where I met my wife, Di. They're picking fruit in outside of Mildura.
They married and had two daughters while working in the extreme heat in the vineyards. Then one day, their two-year-old daughter collapsed in the heat and Tim screamed out to God.
For me, that was that point of saying, "Lord, I'll do anything for you. I'll go anywhere for you. I'll give you my life." And in that prayer and crying and pouring water over this little girl, she began to breathe and cough. And there we really prayed. We really prayed together as a couple for a job that we wouldn't have to work in the heat of the day anymore.
Over the next 25 years, God gave Tim and Di a wide variety of training and ministry. Time in Canberra working in sound archives at the Australian Institute of Aboriginal Studies. Time in Tamworth with university studies and work in drug counselling. Time as pastors of Babinda Church, North Queensland. Establishing a youth campsite for at-risk Indigenous youth in the rainforest at Mission Beach. Helping pioneer a residential kinder to year 12 school in Cairns for children from Indigenous communities from all over Australia and PNG. Travelling the nation with the school children and meeting with the Prime Minister and the Governor General. Pioneering worship events, praise corroboree in the Great Hall of Parliament House, Canberra, and World of Worship in Cairns.
Worship is my heart, my life. Still lead worship today. I love worshiping the Lord for years and years, and still now I still see worship as a strength within our Indigenous churches across Australia.
Tim and Di wanted to hold a worship event in Cairns for people from remote communities, and they linked up with Hillsong and Darlene Check. But that connection came through a tragedy. Tim was out fishing when their boat sank, and he was in the ocean for many hours. His youngest brother and brother-in-law drowned alongside him.
But I was crying out, and I was singing the song, Shout to the Lord. And I sang it for maybe over 3 or 4 hours, just continually. Let every breath, everything that I have, never cease to worship you. I was screaming out to God.
After he was rescued, and Darlene Check heard how God had used her song, and she made a point of meeting up with Tim.
And Darlene said, "Well, yeah, let's plan. Let's not just dream, but we plan, and we made a date and a time for World of Worship." And I think the first year we had maybe over 200 volunteers. So many of those people who weren't working with the Lord that time and came and served with us and served alongside of us, they now have become Christians. One of them is my son-in-law, who is now my associate pastor.
In February 2005, Tim and Di moved to Perth, where they are now senior pastors of Eagle Rock Community Church in the city of Gosnells, which has become a hub for people from remote communities all over Western Australia.
It isn't a large church, but it has a Bible college and a school for at-risk children, and is planning a new church in Tamworth. Its members are involved in feeding the needy every week, ministering in prisons, hospitals and hostels, holding missions across the nation and overseas, and developing their own businesses. But most of all, it's a community of worship and prayer.
The chains of sin and set me free.
See, you answer your prayers, and God will answer, will meet your needs.
On a hill far away, stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame.
That a fool says in his heart, listen, there's no God. In other words, I will be the one who will do this myself.
Well, somebody said that it only takes a spark to get a fire burning. And here we've been talking about the pocket of fire, and it's a spiritual fire, it's fire of the Holy Spirit that had as it started out of a little place like Pinnacle Pocket and Innisfail and other places of North Queensland. As see so many people and many of them in the earlier times were illiterate, but yet they had that strong belief that what Jesus had said, that if, just to wait in this place, the power of the Holy Spirit will come upon you. And you'll be witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth.
Two people who have gone to the world in the power of Holy Spirit are Adam Jaffa and Norm Miller. Norm is the grandson of Linda Barlow, who has already featured a number of times. She and her family lived in Herberton and then on a farm near Atherton before moving to Innisfail in the 1970s. Granny was a powerful influence on everyone around her, including Norm, who has been at the forefront of intercession and warfare for reconciliation in many parts of the world in the last 15 years.
The reconciliation, not only to old and young, black, white, rich, poor, church, church, nation to nation. So the Lord's really been putting it upon our heart that as we've done a lot of reconciliation within Australia, to the point of even Indigenous to Indigenous Aboriginal people to Torres Strait Islander people there as well.
Norm and his wife Barbara have led ministry in many parts of Australia and other parts of the world, including Israel.
The Psalms 24 conference is to allow the King of Glory to come in. And Cairns was the first one. Then we had the next one in Canberra. And we had key leaders, Aboriginal and non-Indigenous leaders also there at that one.
But Granny Barlow's influence on Adam has impacted the world in a different way.
My parents came from Albania and from a Muslim background and settled here. And I was born here, just up the hill in Mariba, on the Atherton Tablelands. I learned all the Arabic prayers, the Muslim Arabic prayers in that language, and English and Albanian. I knew it in three different languages at a very early age, actually. My dad was a tobacco grower, retired while I was growing up, and then later on I grew tobacco for about 8 years.
Adam married a local girl, Fitrit Mehmet, with the same Albanian Muslim background as himself. Fitrit's parents had a large family, and they also had an Aboriginal family, the Barlows, living and working on their farm. Granny Barlow really prayed for years for Fitrit's family to know Jesus as their Saviour and Lord.
We made the decision to follow Christ in 1980, 3 years after we were married. We had threats on our lives and what have you in the first year especially, really because of my conversion, but mainly because I wouldn't stop witnessing to other Muslims. That really infuriated them.
About 5 years later, they joined up with Pinnacle Pocket Church. Pastor Eddie and Rita Turpin and Joe Allier, an evangelist from Pinnacle Pocket, had a lifelong influence on Adam and Fitrick.
So we were there for approximately 5 or 6 years in all, till about 1991, when we ultimately began to plant our first church, and we've continued to plant churches since then, and particularly fairly prolific in crusades overseas and beginning now locally here in Australia as well, and working a lot with a lot of aid work over those nearly 20 years now.
That work has taken Adam to the front line of wars, as well as the heads of government in 40 nations in the last 20 years.
So through that period of time, we saw hundreds of thousands of people come to Christ.
About 6 months after 9/11, Adam felt the Lord lead him to Pakistan.
We estimate somewhere around 70,000 people, most of them Muslim, came to Christ. Amazing miracles. There were, we're not stretching the story to say many thousands, if not tens of thousands of people were healed.
I've had the privilege to minister in many nations around the globe. Our heart is for mission and to take the Great Commission to reach people, to teach them and to release them, but making sure that they're empowered by the Holy Spirit. And I know that many of the other ministries that you've seen on this video have taken the gospel and did it really hard in the sense of travels to many places, not only just travel there, but planted churches there and stayed there and empowered others with the precious gift and the fire of the Holy Spirit. So today I just commend and salute great men and women of God who have been able to catch the fire and to take a little spark out of a pocket of fire and taking it not only to this nation of Australia, but also to nations around the world.
I want to see revival spread right throughout this nation. Australia has not truly seen a move of God, a true move of God, and I'm longing to see that. For revivals to take place, there has to be a total commitment and a dedication to what you believe that the Lord's laid upon your heart.
I mentioned earlier, you know, our lives are certainly under serious threat, and not of harm, death. And knowing that we'd had to come to a place, I remember conscientiously making a decision. And I remember saying to Fitra, I said, look, the truth is, you know, I said, we've got something now that's so valuable that there's no price big enough that we can't pay. And I said, if it means that if they do kill me or kill you or both of us, then that's the way it's going to be, because there is no way, after having tasted what we've tasted, that we'll go back. The final word would be this, that, you know, live for God. Anyone who's watching this, live for God with all of your might, with all of your being, every part of you. Don't live a half-hearted life, but give every part, everything you've got, to see His kingdom come. Let your kingdom come.
Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or imagine, according to His power that works within us. To Him be the glory in the Church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forever. Amen.